a Lima, sírvanse revisar sus boletos a la brevedad posible. All passengers boarding Lima flight, please have tickets checked as soon as possible.
Well, this is where I leave you. I trust you've enjoyed your tour of Cusco, the city of lights.
If you're ever in Detroit.
I know, Mr. Potter. I'll come by for dinner. Thank you.
Well, it's been very enjoyable. I've enjoyed the trip.
If you're wondering how you're going to pay me without hurting my feelings, Miss Morris, forget it. Just take out your roll and start counting.
You're not exactly timid, are you?
Not about money. Money sings, and I love music.
Most men don't enjoy taking money from women.
That's the best kind. It's the hardest to get. It always smells so good.
The following is a paid advertisement. Really? A paid advertisement? Wait, the B-movie cast got paid? Yes, the following is a paid advertisement. This episode of the B-Movie Cast is brought to you by the estate planning services of Twyla Minear Brooks, attorney at law. Remember, when the zombie apocalypse comes, things will move pretty fast.
The body should be disposed of at once, preferably by cremation.
Well, how long after death, then, does the body become reactivated?
It's only a matter of minutes.
Minutes? Well, that doesn't give people time to make any arrangements.
No, you're right. It doesn't give them time to make funeral arrangements. The bodies must be carried to the street and burned. They must be burned immediately. Soak them with gasoline and burn them. The bereaved will have to forego the dubious comforts that a funeral service will give. They're just dead flesh and dangerous.
So don't leave your estate planning needs until the last minute, because you don't know when that last minute could come. Call Twyla Minear Brooks, attorney at law, at 859-351-2294. That's 859-351-2294. Remember, when you go, you don't want people saying,
"Yeah, they're dead. They're all messed up."
Twyla Minear Brooks, attorney at law, is licensed for practice in the state of Kentucky. Consult your local attorney for matters outside of the state of Kentucky.
Command mark. The time will be running at X minus 20 seconds. Mark. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Fire.
Spawned by the continuing decline and fall of society as we know it, and created on the second floor spare bedroom studio in the Piedmont of South Carolina, podcasting on a shoestring budget and changing the world one freak at a time. It's the B-Movie Cast with your host, Vince Rotolo.
From coast to coast and worldwide via the internet, this is the B-Movie Cast, the podcast of unusual film and television.
Hi, guys, and welcome back to the B-Movie Clubhouse for episode 465 of the B-Movie Cast. Before I go any farther, I want to get our contact information out of the way. We love hearing from all of you, so we have a feedback segment devoted to your comments and suggestions, and this is how you can contact us. Option 1, pick up your phone and dial 888-936-0808. This is a toll-free number and a very easy way to leave a voice message. Option 2, you can make your own MP3 file and send it in to bmoviecast@gmail.com. Or use your smartphone voice software and record a call, then just send that in as an attachment instead. Or option 3, if you're not into talking, you can just shoot us an email to bmoviecast@gmail.com. Our website is bmoviecast.com, where you can subscribe to the podcast. It's free. And there you can join us on the Facebook B-MovieCast fan page and letterbox. Also, you can play the contest by sending in your answer by email to bmoviecast@gmail.com with contest in the subject line. And check out the links while you're there or buy a t-shirt. I currently have smalls 2-4Xs. If you want to help us financially, there's a donation box you can click on as a supporter on the Lugosi, Karloff, Agar, and the infamous Xanadu level through PayPal. Also, the easiest way to donate is to click on the Amazon bar on the right side of our homepage. This Amazon link will take you to Amazon.com to make your purchase. It doesn't cost you anything, and you can still log into your personal accounts when you get there. It's completely private, so think about us before you buy online. So now, through the miracle of modern technology and thousands of miles of wires, server farms, PCs, Macs, the internet, and duct tape, we have our co-host from Lexington, Kentucky, author, editor, screenwriter, film producer, Nick Brown. He has a new website. It is authornickbrown.com. That's AUTHORNICBROWN.com. He is the author of the Werewolf for Hire book series, starting with Blood Curse. He's also selling a book in collaboration with his wife, Fiona, the B-Movie Cookbook. All of these are available on Amazon. He's produced two movies, Wretch and Loss Prevention. Both can be ordered on Blu-rays or DVDs through Amazon. He is also the producer of a third film, the soon-to-be-released Fall of Usher. Our special guest host back again today is Eric Brook. Eric is a curator at Ashland, the Henry Clay Estate. He's also an amateur Egyptologist and an authority on mummy movies. Ooh, we have to do some more mummy movies. Eric has written reviews and articles for Nick's website, and he and Nick have been watching films together for 35 years. Today's movie is a pick from Eric Brooks, our resident Egyptologist and historian. It is called Secret of the Incas, and it's an adventure film from 1954 starring Charlton Heston, Robert Young, and Nicole Maurey. You'll recognize the hat from the Indiana Jones, and be prepared for singing interludes, multiple singing interludes, and 1950s politically incorrect behavior. And thank you, Nick, for sneaking in a quasi-musical on me.
Hey, well, I was just about to say, Mary, first off, I did not sneak it in.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this was Eric's pick. That's okay. Number one. And number two, what have I told you, Mary? If you close your eyes, it's not a musical. You're just listening to music.
Ooh, that was hard not to even listen to sometimes.
Well, you know,
when she hit those high ranges.
Her voice was amazing,
yeah.
But I'm going to say this. I swear to God, I thought it was a theremin at one point.
I did, too.
It does sound that way.
Yeah.
And it was her voice. I mean, what the heck?
I know.
But wait. We're totally going off.
Yeah,
let's do our...
Okay, let's do this.
Why are you talking to us?
Hush!
Talk, Mary. why are you not talking, Mary?
Okay. Paramount decided to make this film mostly because there hadn't been one shot in Peru before. And adventure films were real popular, the ones outside of America then, so that's why they did it. Scenery is spectacular. It's filmed in Cusco and Machu Picchu. Unfortunately, I had to watch a streaming version on YouTube that wasn't the best quality. But the DVD is available for sale at Amazon. I think it's like $15. But now I want to go back and watch Raiders of the Lost Ark, because according to the Raiders costume designer Deborah Landis, it's almost shot for shot Raiders of the Lost Ark. I really don't remember Raiders of the Lost Ark. It's been so long.
But wait.
What?
You don't remember Raiders of the Lost Ark, Mary?
Not the story. I mean, I remember bits and pieces of it, but it's been like 20 years since I've seen that movie.
Oh,
well,
dude.
it's only on all the time.
Yes.
Where?
TV!
Huh. Yeah, it's on all the time, all kinds of things.
Huh,
it may
yeah.
be on Disney Plus now. I don't know.
I don't think they're on Disney Plus, because Paramount isn't a Disney a property.
Well, I was thinking because it was a Lucasfilm thing, but maybe it's not.
It will be on the Paramount streaming network, dude.
I'm sure.
Yeah, here's the thing. Lucas was involved in it, but it was a Paramount picture.
Yeah. That's true.
Yeah.
So I bet it's going to be on the new Paramount streaming service.
Yes.
Because hashtag everyone has a streaming service.
Yeah, tell me about it.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, my biggest problem with this movie was I didn't like the Charlton Heston character, just because he was greedy and seedy, and I mean, Indiana Jones was greedy, but he did it for the archaeology, not for the money.
Okay,
in it, so.
whoa,
what?
Indiana Jones was like the opposite of greedy, Mary.
Well, he was greedy because he wanted it so bad. I mean, it was like he had to have, you know.
He wanted it to preserve it for world, the betterment of the world, or at least so it could be stuck in a giant warehouse and forgotten until a really, really unnecessary fourth movie is made where they can do a callback to it during the opening scene. But let's not go there, because I pretend Kingdom of the Crystal Skull didn't happen.
Okay, that's the fourth one?
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah, Indiana Jones and the Search for Bad CGI Monkeys. I mean, the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. Sorry.
Okay. Anyway.
Anyway.
Like I said, that's my problem. You know,
now, the whole 1950s. Totally,
yeah, he was not a nice person.
He was... not a nice person. He was a Heston.
That's true. He kind of did the Grinch thing at the end. His heart grew 3 sizes, and he did the right thing.
Oh, that's please. Three sizes? It grew like a quarter size bigger.
Mm-hmm.
And that was mostly because he was all horny for what's her name, Nicole Maurey.
He's true. Like,
if I do something really nice for her, perhaps she will go with me instead of the dude from Father Knows Best. Hmm. Oh, wait. Spoiler alert, guys. We're gonna spoil the hell out of this movie. Mm-hmm. So, as Mary said, it's not readily available on streaming services like Amazon or Netflix.
Yeah.
So you can find a complete version of it on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure you can find the DVD from a certain DVD dealer that we might know.
That's true.
Yes. Whose name starts with a J and ends with a on. That would be Juan. So, you know, feel free to hit him up for a copy of it, because I bet that he's got a copy.
I'm sure he does, yeah. Yep.
And if he doesn't, he knows a guy who knows a guy who knows a guy who can get him.
It's true.
Trust me.
Yeah. Anyway.
I derailed you. Sorry,
yeah,
Mary.
Yeah, you did. Well, I'm done.
Oh, you're done.
I'm done.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Eric, Mary and I have been griping about Charlton Heston being kind of a Heston.
You better explain that.
We better explain that. You're right. So, Mary, why don't you explain it?
Oh, you go ahead.
Okay, so Mary, before we started podcasting, says to me, here's a fun fact, Nick. And I said, what's that, Mary? In Greece, Charlton Heston's name is changed. And I said, really? Why? Because apparently Heston is very close to a Greek word for... well, actually, they said, what was it, scatological word?
Yes.
So, a scatological word, and I just focused on the word scat in scatological and figured out that it's a duty-related word. So, yes. Yeah, Heston is poopy.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm saying poopy because I'm trying to keep the podcast nice and clean.
Thank you.
You're welcome, Heston. So just remember, every time I'm saying Heston, it's unless I'm actually saying Charlton. Charlton? Yeah, Charlton, yeah. Heston. For a second, I wanted to say Charleston.
Well, his name really was Charles.
Well, Charlton Heston.
No, I mean in real life.
Well, yeah, you can shorten Charlton to Charles.
No, his name was like Charles... what is it? Wait a minute. I have this here. Because I looked this up, too. His real name was John Charles Carter.
Ah.
That sound like that Mars thing?
Right.
From
you know
Burroughs?
What? I'm going to say, he changed his name on somebody's advice in Hollywood.
Because it sounded like the Burroughs character.
That's so?
I don't know what, so they made him change his name because of that.
Oh, good Lord. Do you think Mike Tarzan changed his name?
I guess, because I don't know who Mark Tarzan is.
Well, first of all, it's Mike Tarzan.
Oh, okay.
And second, I made him up.
Oh. Heston.
Heston. So, Eric, what's your biggest Heston about this movie?
My biggest Heston about this movie? I don't know. I guess probably the same as your all's. Charlton Heston's character, Harry Steele, is pretty much a jerk.
He is. That, he's a jerk.
You know, he's willing to run through anybody and destroy archaeological remains, etc., simply to satisfy his need to make a quick buck and get into the pants of a Romanian lady.
Any lady.
Any lady, yeah. The Romanian one was convenient, so, you know.
Yeah.
She worked out in a lot of ways for him, I guess. Or would have worked out, could have worked out. Whatever.
Yeah, Marion Ross is in this movie. Cunningham. Mrs. Cunningham from Happy Days.
She is?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, she's the lady that was on the tour that was all hot for him.
Was she the wife of the guy and she kept telling him to go take a nap?
Yes.
Okay.
She was the lady who was totally on her trip to Peru to score with the tour guide. And she just, I mean, good Lord, if she'd come on any harder to old Charlton Heston, he would have, I don't know, he would have had been blind to miss it. But I thought he was doing an admirable job of, okay, my take on his character was, he was deciding if it was worth sleeping with her or not.
Yeah.
Up until he had the opportunity to meet somebody hotter.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So
he's a jerk.
Yeah. Yeah, because he was kind of a jerk. And that's okay. By the way, I do want to take a moment. You know, we mentioned that this was Eric's pick for a movie.
Mm-hmm.
I do have to say thank you, Eric, for bringing this film to our attention.
True.
There's a lot to like about the film other than Heston. And
well, I mean, he's a good actor because he played the part so well. You despise him.
Oh, that's it. I mean, he's a really good actor, and, you know, he does have a little bit of redemption there at the end, but spoiler alert. But I'm really pleased you brought it to our attention because, A, it was interesting to see a film shot on location in Peru.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And, B, it was really interesting to see how much Indiana Jones was influenced by this film.
I know.
Yes.
Now, I don't buy that it's a shot-for-shot remake.
Yeah, it's not. I don't either.
No.
Yeah.
It's not at all.
Yeah.
But the dude was, I mean, if he'd had a bullwhip, that would have been it.
Right.
She said the whole crew watched that movie quite a few times. The whole crew.
Surprised me a bit.
Yeah. Definitely influenced him.
I mean, right down to the revolver he was carrying looked like the same type of revolver.
Same gun.
Huh.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to watch that movie again.
There's
never a bad time to watch Raiders.
That's the one where he has the bag of, like, sand, and he's weighing it out in his hand.
Right.
Yes.
And then the big ball comes down.
Yes.
Okay.
That is
the beginning of the movie where he's running through the jungle and he goes into the temple and to get the golden statue. That's supposed to be in Peru.
Mm-hmm.
He is supposedly going to a Chachapoyan temple. The Chachapoya culture was in northern Peru, a good ways from Machu Picchu. But it is a culture that was eventually overtaken by the Inca. So that's in Peru. The Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, which don't bother with it. It has some nice nostalgia moments, but A, the primary artifact is completely debunked and fake, so why bother? And B, it just, I don't know, just didn't really work. Doesn't help that Shia LaBeouf went off the deep end, and so whatever they were thinking about handing off to Shia LaBeouf, that's gone.
Yeah.
But Kingdom of the Crystal Skull also takes place mainly in Peru. And that's actually supposed to be in the Peruvian highlands.
The Crystal Skull was?
They did go back to that.
Why do I think the Crystal Skull was in China?
Was what?
Why do I think it was set in China?
I don't know. The only part of any of the films that is set in China is the beginning of Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom. That starts in Shanghai, and then they board a plane and fly to India.
Hmm.
Yep.
Okay.
But otherwise, none of the rest of the films are set in China.
Huh.
Nepal, Raiders of the Lost Ark in the middle.
Well, anyway. It was hard to find Nazis in China.
Right.
And let's face it, the best Indiana Jones movies were Indiana Jones fighting Nazis.
Yes, absolutely.
I mean, that's all there is to it. I mean, okay, in Temple of Doom was okay, but come on.
What was the first one?
That was Raiders of the Lost Ark.
And Temple of Doom was the second one.
Right.
Yep. And then, what was it? Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade was the third one, yeah.
Which is the one that had James Bond in it?
John Connery well, none in of the Last them. Crusade.
Okay.
It had Sean Connery.
He plays,
I couldn't remember his name.
Henry Jones Sr.
By the way, Hot Shots fun fact, Connery was only like 11 years older or something like that than Harrison Ford, but he was playing his dad.
Was he That's really? Correct.
Yep.
Yeah.
Absolutely true.
Yep.
Wow.
So, there you go.
He either and aged really, badly or they had good makeup on him.
You know what? Sean Connery was just being Sean Connery, and he's looked like he was 65 since he was probably 45.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yes.
I mean,
all those years playing James Bond in Tropical Sunlight will do that to you.
No, I think it was being Zardoz in that little mankini.
Yeah, that
Once
would,
you've
that
done the mankini,
either, yeah.
that'll age you.
Oh.
That'll age the viewer if it doesn't age him. That's
exactly.
Sure.
Man, I wish I had that sound clip right now.
Yes.
Zardoz.
Hey, but, should we do the contest first before we go any further?
I think.
Sure, why not?
My goodness, yes. What was the film, Mary?
Hillbillies in a Haunted House from 1967.
Yes,
have you seen that movie?
I have seen it several times on Riff Tracks.
Oh, okay.
And, okay, let me give you the skinny on it. I don't know much of the history of why it was made, but what I do know is it has Lon Chaney Jr. and John Carradine and Basil, oh, God, what's his name? Basil
Rathbone.
Yeah, Rathbone. And they're in it playing campy villains. It has a guy in a gorilla suit running around.
Wow.
I mean, it's... You wouldn't like it at all, Mary, because it's sort of a musical.
Oh, wow. Who are the hillbillies?
What?
Who are the hillbillies?
Well, the hillbillies are the musicians. They're on their way to Nashville for a jamboree.
Okay.
That was it. And hold on a minute. I should have looked this up. Hillbillies in a Haunted House. Because I think it's Mel Tillis is the main hillbilly.
Wow.
I
want
to say. Yeah.
Wow.
Because it was a country music vehicle. So, yeah, let's see.
That was Vince's big claim to fame. Mel Tillis came to his house.
Oh, it wasn't Mel Tillis. It was Merle Haggard.
Oh, okay. Never mind.
So sorry about that. But Mel Tillis is also awesome. So there you go. Yeah, it was John Carradine, Lon Chaney Jr., Basil Rathbone, Merle Haggard. Who else was in it? Oh, Joy Lansing.
Don't know that.
You know, it's a fun little movie.
Okay.
You know. It's worth checking out.
Okay.
So, Hillbillies in a Haunted House.
Okay.
There you go.
Well, our first movie has been donated again by Patrick Kelly. The movie
Sweet.
Is Serenity, and it's a Blu-ray from 2005. Pat writes that this film is a continuation of the short-lived TV science fiction series Firefly. This film, directed by Joss Whedon, was a result of sheer fan power and a cult of admirers who refused to let their favorite groundbreaking spaceship series die. I love that series.
Yep. And have you seen Serenity?
Yeah, I have. I have.
Okay. You remember it. So
that
it
guy,
must be good.
That guy that played the pilot?
Yeah, wait. Are you about to drop a spoiler on Serenity?
No. I don't think so.
I don't know. Are you?
No.
What were you about to say? And his name was Alan Tudyk.
Yeah, he's in a series now.
Yes. A couple of series.
Resident Alien.
Resident Alien.
Yeah, Resident Alien.
Yeah, and it's good.
Just
I like
started watching that.
Yeah, it's fun.
It is.
Yeah. I like when people, aliens turn into humans and try to be human.
Well, I have a question about it.
What?
Where do you watch it?
On television.
On good Lord. What channel is it on, Mary?
Sci-fi.
Oh, okay. I don't have cable, so I can't watch it.
Oh, okay. Sci-fi doesn't stream on anything?
Probably. I don't know.
Okay.
I gave up on the Sci-Fi Channel a long time ago after they quit showing sci-fi shows and switched to making really bad movies only.
Yeah,
I was like, I'm going to give up.
Well, now they're starting to do some series and stuff that are pretty good.
Oh, cool.
Yep.
Well, I will try and check that out.
It's fun. Resident Alien. I like it. Anyway, let's see. Our first winner of the Serenity Blu-ray is Don Falcus.
Well, it's good he didn't win a koozie. From what I hear, Don Falcos is only a couple of koozies away from you owing him a car, Mary.
Oh, stop it. T-shirt.
Okay. Telling you, no, Mary, we've already promised him a car. I'm sorry.
Oh, God.
And the B-movie cast does not renege on its promises.
Okay.
Okay, folks.
You putting the money in for a car?
What?
You putting the money in for the car?
No. I dropped that one squarely on you, Mary.
Okay, well, I'll just have to take Don Falcos' name off the list when he shows up from now on.
I tell you what, I will pay for the postage.
Oh, okay.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. All right. Okay. Our second movie was donated by Santito. It's The Woman on Pier 13, a.k.a. I Married a Communist from 1949. Mm. It stars Robert Ryan, John Agar, and Lorraine Day. It's about a newly married Brad Collins, who is Robert Ryan, once belonged to the Communist Party. The party wants to pull him back in to stir up a labor strike. And this is like one of those Hollywood movies that exploited the whole Red Scare thing. And, yeah, it's pretty good. Okay. And the winner of that one is Andrew Quinn. So congratulations, Andrew. I'll get it to you as soon as possible with our mail system. Who knows? And our last prize is a B-movie koozie. And that goes to Doug Farini. Congratulations,
oh, hi, Doug. How close to a car is Doug, Mary?
I'm not sure. I have it written down on a piece of paper somewhere.
See, she's tracking you car winners. I'm just saying.
It's because I'm scared. Okay, let's get on to the movie. Secret of the Incas.
Yes. Well, do we want to let Eric talk about this one a little bit since it was his pick?
Yes.
Great.
Tell us about the movie, Eric.
Okay. So this film piqued my interest because it is, in fact, one of the major source inspirations for Indiana Jones. And as Nick knows well, Indiana Jones, in all of his various forms, is one of my favorite characters. And the Indiana Jones films, at least the first three, are among my favorite films of all time. And in fact, I do what I do today. I work in a museum. I am a curator, largely because of Indiana Jones.
Wow.
The scene in Raiders of the Lost Ark when the federal guys come to the college to tell him about the Ark, and they ask him what's an Ark, and he whips out the giant Bible and shows them the Ark and tells them all about it. When I saw that, I knew that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to be the guy that people could come to and say, what is this?
Wow.
What does it mean? What's the story here? And I could tell them that. When I saw that, and I was 10 or 11, 80 or 81, whenever it was that came out, I knew that's what I wanted to do. I was already interested in archaeology. I love archaeology. I don't ever remember really not loving archaeology. And, of course, that film is predominantly about Raiders of the Lost Ark is about Egypt, which mm-hmm. is my main passion. But it's been an important part of my life. But it definitely influenced my career track and my life's activities. My father and I have now traveled to a lot of places, and I feel very fortunate we've had that opportunity, number of which are featured in Indiana Jones films. Egypt is one of them. Peru is another. We've done that trip, so we've done several others. I've been to Tibet, which is close to Nepal, is similar to Nepal in many ways. Been to China, although not to Shanghai. So I've had the opportunity to have some of that adventure, and it's been a lot of fun. But to see this film and to see the roots of this character, I thought were really cool. Plus, for me, because this was shot on location in Peru, Dad and I did a trip to Peru, and it's done very much like they show it in the film. It didn't start in Lima. Most of the time now, tours go first to Lima. They fly from Lima to Cusco. Then from Cusco, they go through what's called the Valle Sagrada, or Sacred Valley, which is a valley between Cusco and Machu Picchu.
Isn't that a train? Don't you take a train to do that?
To Machu Picchu, then back to Cusco, mm-hmm. and then from Lima to home. So we did that. We flew into Cusco, immediately boarded a bus, and went to the Sacred Valley. And one of the reasons they do that is that Cusco sits at about 12,000 feet. As you can really feel that. That's significant altitude. That's enough that for most people, you can feel the lack of oxygen.
And wow.
It slows you down.
I thought there's a train that goes from Cusco to Machu Picchu.
There is.
Okay.
Yes. We took the train. When we did it, we went to the Sacred Valley, spent several days going through Incan ruins in the Sacred Valley and visiting local towns. The town at the start of the film, the very opening of the film, I don't know if that's the town we visited, but it looked just like that.
Hmm.
Little old buildings along a small street. First time I ever used an internet cafe was in that town. It was in this weird
wow.
little store. They had, like, you know, chickens and eggs and various things on one side, and this little wooden stall on the other with this ancient computer in it, which we used to send emails home. So, anyway, Dad has a picture. I have a picture somewhere that my dad took.
So what year did you go?
Cafe. What?
What year were you there?
2006.
Okay.
Left on Memorial Day weekend, 2006, and we're gone about 12 or 13 days, something like that.
I was like 50 years after this movie.
Right.
And it still looked the same.
Close to it, yeah. And it's
wow.
You know, grown a lot. When they show the airport in Cusco, that's a significant... I don't know that it's an international airport. I'm not sure you can fly into Cusco from, at least from the United States. You may be able to. I'm sure you can from Bolivia or perhaps Ecuador or places like that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a significant airport, pretty large.
Oh, okay.
And very, very nice.
Okay.
And it's a pretty good-sized city now, spread out all through, all across the mountains there. So we flew in there and then went on. And we actually, the river that they raft down,
mm-hmm.
we rafted down that river. And a raft almost exactly like the one in the film. That's called the Urubamba River.
Is it a
tour? It flows
through
the Sacred Valley and below Machu Picchu. You could theoretically raft all the way to Machu Picchu, but we got out eventually and took a train most of the way. And that's the primary means to get to Machu Picchu.
Okay.
I'm not sure it's possible to drive from Cusco to Machu Picchu.
Okay.
I think at some point you would have to take the train. But you take the train to a little town called Aguas Calientes, which is down below Machu Picchu. And there are lots of hotels and restaurants and things there. But then you can stay down there and then go up to Machu Picchu. And we got there in the middle of the day, had lunch, went up for the afternoon, came back down to our hotel. And the next morning, we went up at sunrise. So we were there for sunrise at Machu Picchu, which is spectacular.
Wow.
It's an incredibly beautiful place, just like it looks in the film. just incredibly, the views, the vistas are unbelievable. I mean, it sits in a saddle between two mountains called Machu Picchu and Huayna Picchu, and it's at about 8,000 feet. So it's 8,000 feet, and it's a pretty sheer drop to the valley below. So you feel like you're right on top of a mountain. It's pretty wild. But it's become now a UNESCO, it's a UNESCO World Heritage Site. It's also one of the new Seven Wonders of the World. There's actually a hotel at Machu Picchu now.
That's what I thought, yeah.
Up at the top, outside the ruins.
Yeah.
It's a very nice, very, very expensive hotel. They oxygenate the rooms and things like that. So,
I might have to save up for that one.
It's a trip that's well worth doing. It's a spectacular place.
Yeah.
And they did a good job with that. For the most part, what they said about it is true, although it's not nearly as old as they talk about it. Machu Picchu was built about 1425 and abandoned by the 1570s.
Okay.
So not in use very long, really, and not as old as some would think. But it's at the height of the Inca civilization.
Did they ever figure out why it was abandoned? Because I know that when I was researching it, that was kind of listed as a mystery.
Well, yeah, it's not really clear. I mean, obviously the Inca civilization was, like so many other civilizations, obliterated by European contact.
Mm-hmm.
The Spanish showed up. They murdered many of them. Others died from disease. Some were enslaved, but the civilization ceased to exist, essentially. I mean, there are still people, there are descendants of the Inca today, for sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But the civilization, the empire, came to an end. And I suspect that what really happened is it just ceased to be used. And I don't know why the Spanish never made it there.
It was a long way up that hill, dude.
It was a long way out there, and it has no strategic value, really.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not a place from which you can launch further campaigns or whatever. It's an end in itself. The only thing that the Spanish would have gone there to do if they had known or thought that it would have been worth it is that they would have gone there to loot it, to take the treasures, take the gold, et cetera.
Yeah.
But I guess they either never figured out it was there or just had enough gold elsewhere that they just didn't feel the need to go to Machu Picchu. So it was forgotten about until 1911. And an American explorer by the name of Hiram Bingham, who was operating under the auspices of the Peabody Museum at Yale University, went looking for a community called Vilcabamba, which is like a last holdout of the Incas, and learned of this city in the clouds and eventually went there, and it was Machu Picchu. And he is the one who sort of first led the effort to rescue it from the jungle, if you will. It had become so completely overgrown, it's almost completely hidden by the jungle. So they cleared it, and it's become a major tourist site, obviously.
Yeah.
Although they've still only uncovered 30 or 40% of the total site.
Wow.
So there's an awful lot of it that's still in the jungle today. And they've done that intentionally because they just don't have the resources to preserve all that other site, the rest of the site. So leave it as it is. And if the time comes when they do, then I guess they can consider expanding it. But
yeah, I've heard that during rainy seasons, even that railroad is perilous.
Yes.
I can see where it gets washed out a lot. And yeah.
Yeah. I mean, to get there from Aguascalientes, you go up this tiny road. It's just a one switchback after the other all the way up to the top. And yeah, if it were really raining or something, it could be pretty scary. I mean, it's a pretty steep drive, no question about it. It's a spectacular place.
I knew somebody that hiked in. I don't know where they hiked in from. But, oh, man, I can't imagine. How many days would it take?
Well, it depends on where you start from.
Okay.
Dad and I actually contemplated that option because one of the things you can do, there are companies you can go with where they hire porters. And you walk along during the day, camp at night, and hike the Inca Trail, which takes you up and enters the site through what's called the Sun Gate, which is up at the top of Machu Picchu, and then you go down the hill into the site itself. Which is a neat thing to do. It's the way the Incas did it. But obviously you're hiking at altitude, which is challenging. Yeah. And I am relatively glad that I convinced my dad, let's just take the other tour and go by bus. That's just a much easier way to go. Let's just not try to kill ourselves here.
So
that would have been a challenge. We saw them doing it. I mean, you drive along in the on the train or whatever, or in the truck going up there, and, or on the bus going up there, and you see these guys carrying, you know, large backpacks and tents and everything. And, of course, the local people are just trotting right along, running right along. You know, and everybody else kind of huffing and puffing, but doesn't bother the local people at all.
Yeah.
So, well, they're acclimated to it.
Yes, they are. They've actually evolved certain physical traits to deal with it. Most of the people of that region are short of stature, which reduces the distance the blood has to circulate. They have lungs that are 15 or 20% larger than ours.
Wow.
And blood that is richer in iron, so that it utilizes the oxygen available in a much more efficient manner. So they physically are adapted to that environment. So it, it does not impact them the way it would you or me.
Wow.
So it's an interesting trip. It's a really beautiful place. Mm-hmm. And we saw a lot of people in the kinds of costume that you see in the film.
Wow.
You see them like that. We went to a place where they make textiles, you know, a bunch of women making textiles. They were in that costume. And then you see them around at sites. I guess some people make a living by putting on their costume and going out to Machu Picchu or Ollantaytambo or any of the other major sites and just kind of standing around, so that when you say, may I take your picture? They say, yeah, sure, for five nueve soles or whatever, and you pay them your money and get your picture. It's like going to Comic-Con. Yeah, you can take my picture for $10.
Yeah, it's like the gladiators in the Forum in Rome.
Probably,
they do
yeah.
the same thing. They make their living doing that. Yeah. Oh, well. Got to do it somehow.
But you can see the elements of Indy in this really clearly. The costuming is obviously there. The fedora, the leather jacket, the bag, the gun.
So do you have the fedora?
I have a fedora. I have the leather jacket. I can kind of fake the pants and the shirt and the shoes. And I have a bag that will work. It's not the most accurate bag. I'm working on that. For those of you out there in the B-movie land who are interested, if you want to do this and really do it right, there is a site, a website called indiegear.com that literally has every single prop and costume item from the film to every possible dimension, material, etc. For example, the fedoras in Indiana Jones in the first three films were all rabbit fur. In the fourth film, it was a beaver fedora. So I don't know how they managed to dig all of this up, but they have all of the specifications. So you can get your costume exactly perfectly screen accurate if you want to do that.
So the hats are furry?
Well, yeah. Most hats like that are made of some kind of fur.
Oh, I just thought they were tanned leather. I didn't realize they had fur on.
No, no. The fedoras are felt. Felt is made by pressing fur. It's compressed fur. So the fedora in the Charlton Heston wearing is some kind of fur, I guess. But yeah, that's where that's the beginning of the look. Now, Charlton Heston's jacket is a vintage World War II A2 fighter jacket with the patches on it, aviator jacket. They tried that with Indy. They removed the elastic on the sleeves and at the waist, but it didn't. The A2 is designed in a way that it interfered with the whip and the gun, so they had had the costume people do a
alteration,
sort of a revised model, which they made in canvas or something, and then made leather ones off of it. So it's a little different. It's not a jacket that precisely shows up in stores. It's not a model that is readily available, but you can get one. I have one that I think is actually pretty similar because it's straight at the bottom, you know, has some of the features that the one that Indy wears has. So, yeah, I have some of that stuff, and I do that. It's a nice cosplay. It's relatively easy to do. It's functional. You know, I see these people who go to Comic-Con, and they do these really elaborate, some character with a giant sword and all kinds of armor, and it looks really good, but they can't sit down all day long. They can't pick up anything or do anything because their hands are constantly full of sword or whatever. And I just think, that looks great. I really appreciate you doing that so we can see it. But, God, that's got to be annoying. I mean, that's just got to wear you out after a while. Yeah. And I want to enjoy the show. So Indy works really well for that. Hmm. And I like it. It's a great character. It's lots of fun.
So what Comic-Con do you go to?
Lexington Comic-Con, Scarefest. Nick and I went once to Cincinnati Comic Expo.
Yep.
There's one in Louisville that I've been to.
Oh.
Mostly around here. I have not yet ventured to further afield.
Okay.
Well, you know, Eric, if you make it to the Monster Bash, you got to bring your indie outfit. I'm just saying.
I will gladly do that. And God willing, I will make it there someday in the near future.
Woo-hoo.
That's the plan. We'll see what happens. Are they still planning for it for this year?
Who knows?
It depends on whether the state of Pennsylvania lifts all the restrictions on the hotels.
Huh.
That's the problem right now.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if they'll be able to do it that quickly or not, really.
Yeah, I know. Well, especially, I'm scheduled to get my first shot on Thursday.
Oh,
yay!
Great.
Yay!
My first COVID shot. And I was talking to my brother, and he said that he's been trying to get one for weeks now up in Pennsylvania, but it's really hard to get a shot in Pennsylvania. And I think Patrick was telling me about that, too. So it seems to be a lot harder in Pennsylvania to get the shot.
It's hit and miss because the states are really running the show right now.
Yeah.
But it's not often that I say, yay, the federal government's stepping in, but yay, the federal government's stepping in, and they're setting up a bunch of different sites. Every state is getting several federal sites.
Oh.
So right. I happen to be in Texas right now for work. And I know Dallas, Houston, and somewhere else are going to have federal COVID vaccination sites.
Okay.
So, and I know Kentucky's going to have a couple also.
Okay.
So, just FYI, Nick Brown, master of COVID vaccination information.
Yes, indeedy.
Well, okay, South Carolina yet.
Well, part of the reason I know all this is I've been trying really, really hard to get my dad vaccinated because he's 80 years old.
Yeah.
And, you know, he still works at the radio station.
Wow.
And, yeah, I know. And he needs to be vaccinated.
Yeah.
So, you know, and the good news is he's going Saturday to get his shot.
Woo-hoo.
So his first.
Yeah.
So we're happy about that.
Yeah.
My folks have both gotten their shot, first shot at UK. Yeah. So glad of that.
Yep.
Yeah.
So it all kind of depends on whether Pennsylvania can get it together and get enough people vaccinated, I guess.
So we might as well not plan on it.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like it right now.
I think it would be pushing it this year to get it in. But
yeah,
I will get there one day, sooner or later, come hell or high water.
Yep. I hope it's soon.
Well, okay, we kind of went down the side hole.
I know. Okay.
But that's okay, because we were talking about, you know, Indiana Jones and cosplay, and that led to this, that, and the other.
Mm-hmm.
And I will say Eric does a great job with his Indiana Jones cosplay, and I figured out the reason that he likes that one so much, though.
Why?
There are two reasons. Number one, he gets to carry a whip.
Yes, indeed.
And number two, he gets to carry the messenger bag that he then uses to carry all of his stuff that he buys at the con around with him.
Exactly.
That's a good idea.
Yes, indeed. So, I wear the messenger bag regardless of whether I'm cosplaying or not, but at least in that case, it looks cool and people think, oh, that's kind of neat. He's got the bag. All right.
Yeah.
So, yes, that is exactly right. A cosplay that makes my bag make sense. It makes it not a man purse.
Yeah.
What's wrong with a man purse?
Nothing.
And Eric speaks Jovitos, too, so that's handy.
Jovitos?
Jovitos, yes.
Which is you weird can tell they them, say Dr. that. Jones,
I guess the people are supposed to be Jovitos, but he's. I don't know. I get very confused because he's supposed to be going into a Chachapoyan temple. I guess the Chachapoyan are extinct, but the Jovitos are the current people living in the area. Which, interesting fact, the thing that he's stealing out of that temple is Aztec. Oh, it's Mexican.
Well, maybe the they were on vacation when they stopped off at that temple.
On a statue in the Dumbarton Oaks Museum in Washington, D.C. And it's a woman, a goddess, giving birth. And the baby is between her legs. If you really look closely at it.
Wow.
Wow.
So.
Okay. Eric has given us facts about Raiders of the Lost Ark that I did not ever want to know. so thank you, Eric.
You are most welcome. And yes, someday I will get some kind of one of the props from one of the films, not one of the actual props, but a replica prop of that sort, so that I can carry something around in my bag when people want to take my picture or whatever and whip it out. You know, the fertility goddess or the Cross of Coronado, or the probably my preference would be the headpiece of the staff of Ra.
Wow.
That would be a good one, but I'm going to make a request, Eric.
Yes.
I don't want you to ever say, I'm going to have something in my bag that I can whip it out when people want to take my picture. Don't ever say those words in that order again, okay?
Heston.
That's my request.
Heston.
Nick always goes to the worst places. Whatever I say,
serious.
He that's the Heston. Image in his mind is the worst possible
that's
image.
That's Nick.
Yeah, that probably is. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would say you're right.
He's a Heston.
He's hey, a you Heston. There you Heston, go.
Oh, really?
I don't take any Heston from you.
Uh-huh.
All right. Okay. So
the thing he's finding in this movie, the secret of the Incas, what is that thing? Is it really Incan?
No. As far as I can tell, that is a made-up piece of business.
Oh, okay.
I have several books on Machu Picchu and the Inca, and I could not find, if that were a real artifact, I think it would be prominently mentioned.
Yeah.
In that kind of literature, and I couldn't find anything related to that.
Okay.
Now there were burials at Machu Picchu, and there were artifacts of a significant nature, most of which ended up at the Peabody Museum at Yale. And within the last 20 years, after years of pressure from the Peruvian government, they gave most of it back.
Oh. So where is it on display in Peru?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
There are several museums in Lima. And in Cusco, that it could be in. I don't know if they built something. There was nothing that I recall being at Machu Picchu where they could display something like that. It's all ruins. There's no, you know, visitor center kind of building, as I recall.
Okay.
There are bathrooms. If you go to the bathroom at Machu Picchu, bring a quarter, because otherwise you can't get toilet paper.
Whoa.
You have to pay the little kid in the bathroom for the toilet paper.
That's good to know.
Helpful
that's
hint.
Creepy. By the way, that's a pro tip. Pro tip for your trip to Machu Picchu.
Either bring your own toilet paper.
Yes, indeed.
Bring a quarter, which is thousands and thousands a lira, or whatever it is they use in Peru.
Huevos soles. They used to use soles, which are mentioned in the film, in Secret of the Incas. He talks several times about paying in soles.
Mm-hmm.
That's the currency. S-O-L-E-S. Sol is a Spanish word for sun. Eventually, that currency got so devalued, it was like 100,000 soles for a loaf of bread or whatever. So they chucked it completely and started fresh with huevos soles. So the new sole. And that was probably 15, 20 years, probably more than that, 25 years ago now. They could have done it like Ecuador did it. Ecuador just abandoned currency altogether, and they use the American dollar. So they don't even print their own money. They just wait for it to come from the United States.
Wow. Ecuador?
Nice.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. The American dollar is what they use. It is the official currency of this nation of Ecuador.
I had trouble with pesos in Mexico.
You just have to peso yourself.
Yeah.
Right.
Heston.
Zardoz.
Oh, okay. So there is a Peruvian singer in this movie called Yuma Sumac.
Yep, Yuma Sumac.
Okay.
Sister of Poison Sumac.
Oh. Oh, I love that, Eric. That's awesome.
Oh. But she was good, and she did come. She came to Hollywood after she was really famous over there, and then came to Hollywood. Her voice is incredible.
Yeah,
I mean, what she does is, I mean, the things that she sings, I've never heard anyone else sing like that. It's truly wild.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I swear, I thought there was a theremin playing.
Yeah, and then it kind of sounds that way.
Oh, it's just her singing. Huh.
Yeah.
I tell you, she sort of reminded me of, in The Fifth Element, there's the opera singer on the space line.
Yeah.
And her voice sort of reminded me of hers.
You're right. You're right.
Yeah. So, but whatever the case, she was amazing.
Yeah. Was she famous at the time of this movie in Hollywood, or did this movie make her famous in Hollywood?
I don't really know.
That's a good question.
She became famous. I think she had
recordings released in the United States. She was on the David Letterman show at one point.
Huh.
Yeah, in 1987, I believe.
Wow.
Because, okay, when I was looking up Secret of the Incas on YouTube to watch it, I actually found her appearance on David Letterman from 1987.
Wow.
So, and bear in mind, she was, let's see, she passed away at the age of 86 in 2008. So she was born in 1922. So yeah, she was only 32 when they did this film.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It looks a lot older to me.
Well, you know.
It's that thin air.
Yes, indeedy.
Wow. The three times that she started singing, that kind of like brought the movie to a halt. But
yeah.
Yeah.
But, okay. If somebody starts singing the way she sings...
Mm-hmm.
Are you really going to go do something else? Are you going to stand there and go, what is going on?
That's true.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah. And also, let's face it, this was on top of Machu Picchu. It wasn't like they were going to the disco or something.
That's true.
Yeah. You know, there wasn't a whole lot of entertainment going on. It's like archaeology or listen to her sing.
Was she kind of like a priestess or something?
She was supposed to be kind of a holy woman, is my impression.
Okay. Yeah.
And I think her brother was the main guy at the of the Peruvians there.
Oh, he was the Pachacutec?
Pachacutec.
Okay.
Yeah, I think he was supposed to be her brother.
Okay.
Incidentally, Pachacutec is the name of the Inca king who built Machu Picchu.
Oh.
Ah, a little throw in for the history folks.
Cool. He's the one that started it.
Okay.
Incidentally, further to that, the word Inca actually is Quechua. It's the language they speak. And the word Inca means king or lord. So the Inca is technically the king of the people.
Oh.
But the Spanish used it to refer to the people themselves. So.
Okay. Well, Michael Pate, the guy that plays his character, I didn't realize this, but he wrote and produced and directed a bunch of stuff. One of them is one of my favorite movies. It's called Tim. It's an Australian movie with Piper Laurie and Mel Gibson in it.
Yeah.
And she plays an older woman, and she has like this thing going with Mel Gibson, who's playing a retarded young guy. It's a really sweet movie.
Oh.
Yeah, but Michael Pate wrote that. And directed it. Yeah, I like that
movie. He was also in a true classic of horror, The Howling 3.
Ah, oh. The Howling 3, The Rise of the Marsupials or something.
Is that the one with the marsupial werewolves or whatever?
Yes, and it has the classic scene where because they're kind of marsupials, like part kangaroo, part werewolf, part whatever. No, you're laughing, Mary. This is the plot. And at one point, one of them is a female, and she's giving birth, and she has a little baby, and it crawls up her belly and gets in her pouch.
Oh, I'm glad I stopped watching those after two.
Well, why did you watch two? That's possibly
I liked one, so I thought I'd watch two. And
actually, that's what happened to so many people.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, indeedy.
And my God, two had Christopher Lee in it.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it did.
Mm-hmm. And Reb Brown. You know who Reb Brown is, don't you, Mary?
I can't remember what it was he in that we just saw.
Your Hunter from the future.
Thank you.
Yeah. Only my favorite movie that we did on the podcast that day.
That day.
Hey, I'm not going to call anything my favorite movie, because as soon as I do, then I remember we did something else that I liked.
I know.
But Yore is the one that I think I played the theme song from the most.
No, okay.
Hey, I'm just saying, Yore, he's the man. And if the viewers would like, I will now insert Yore's theme. No, I'm not going to. I'm not going to. Okay. That's awful. Okay. I'm not going to. We will not derail Secrets of the Incas. No. Bad Yore.
Oh.
It can't be as bad. Fiona and Twyla and I watched These Are the Damned. And it can't be as bad as that song,
that
Black Leather, Kill, 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 or whatever it is.
Yes, that song is destructive to your ears. Because I came away from watching that movie, and I was all depressed.
No.
But at the same time, I was sitting there going, black leather, smash, 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 black leather, crash, 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 oh my! You know, just such an upbeat song for such a depressing movie.
Oh, okay.
That's indeedy.
And, I mean, if you listen to the words are awful, too. It's like, smash, 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 kill, kill, kill.
Yep.
Crash, crash, crash.
Yep.
Oh. So anyway, Secrets of the Incas.
Yeah. Wally Westmore did the special effects makeup.
Ooh.
That's Michael Westmore's father, right?
I can't remember.
I believe that's correct.
Okay. Is he the one that made that guy orange?
What?
Michael
possibly?
Pate, the Pachacutec guy? His face was so orange, it bothered me.
I think that's just maybe the way he appeared on film, and it may be his natural color. I don't know.
Oh, okay.
Some people are just orange, Mary. You know, why are you hating on the Oompa Loompas? Oh, Mary is prejudiced against
Oompa Loompas. Yeah, Wally Westmore is Michael Westmore's dad. Michael Westmore did the makeup for Star Trek The Next Generation, among many others. Yeah. He did a lot of the Star Trek stuff.
Yeah, he's really, really famous.
Yeah, Wally did a lot of the earlier stuff.
Okay.
Obviously did a lot of earlier horror and sci-fi and things like that.
Okay, and the director, Jerry Hopper or Hooper? Hopper.
Hopper, 102Ps, Hopper.
Yep.
Yeah, okay. He didn't really do a whole lot. He switched to TV, it seems like. Like the time tunnel and stuff.
Well, then he did more than you're saying. I mean, he did TV, Mary.
Yeah.
He did just about every TV show going.
Yeah. In the 50s and 60s, yeah. Like. He did one in 1952 called The Atomic City. I'd like to see that. It sounds interesting.
Yeah, that sounds like an interesting film.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it sounds interesting, but let's be honest, guys. If it didn't last, then odds are it's not as interesting as we think.
No, this wasn't a series. This was actually a movie.
Oh, okay. I thought it was a series.
No, this is a movie.
Oh, well, in that case, let's check it out.
I know. I wonder if you could even get that.
We managed to find like Secret of the Incas.
That's true. That's very true.
Which, by the way, what in the world is going on with this movie that it's not available?
It is kind of odd that it's not available. I mean,
guys, because you, okay, Eric, you watched this on Amazon recently, didn't you?
No, I watched it on YouTube. After I told you that, I went back and looked for it, and remembered that it was on YouTube, but I couldn't find it on Amazon.
Okay,
but I did find it on YouTube.
Because I'm wondering if Paramount isn't pulling a bunch of their movies, because this was a Paramount movie.
No, this movie has never been very big. There's a rumor that whoever made the second Indiana Jones, or the Indiana... Who directed Indiana Jones?
Steven Spielberg.
Okay.
Steven Spielberg,
there was a rumor that Spielberg had his hand in, like, destroying this, like, burying this movie. Because he didn't want people saying that this movie is, you know, the beginning of Indiana Jones. But that's a rumor, so I don't think it's true.
Well, I don't know why you'd be worried about that. I mean, yeah, okay, clearly they borrowed ideas like the costume and the use of the little map and the lighting to identify the location of the treasure or whatever, but
these kind
it's
of
a
movies,
distinct enough film that I don't think you would look at it and think, well, they just copied the whole Jones. I mean, it's, you know.
I mean, these are films that have been around for a long time, that kind of action adventure kind of movie anyway, so. That, like I said, that's a rumor. I doubt that it's true. But...
Well, it's a fun rumor to banty about, though.
That's true. That's true.
You know.
It's a lost movie.
Exactly. It's the lost movie. Mm-hmm. Secrets of the cinemas.
Mm-hmm.
With secrets of the Incas. Ha ha, take that. So what else do we have to say about this film?
You want to go through the actors?
Oh, why not? Who was in this? Nobody of any substance was in this film, were they? Only Charlton Heston.
Damn.
Dun, dun, dun.
He was
who
good.
Appeared in, like, over 100 films, and...
And some of them were so great. I mean,
yes.
You're lucky being an actor if you can, like, have two movies that stand the test of time, but, man, he's been in so much stuff.
Well, you know, it was 2 years after this that he was Moses in the Ten Commandments.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, indeedy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Naked Jungle, 54, same year.
Yeah. Naked Jungle. He also did the, what was it, The Greatest Show on Earth in 52.
Yep. That's one of my favorites. I love that film.
Mm-hmm.
And then, okay, what was it that happened to Charlton Heston that he suddenly became Johnny Science Fiction?
I don't know, because he did, like, him, her, and then he did El Cid, and then suddenly
it's like, here's Planet of the Apes, and then the Omega Man, and
Soylent Green.
Soylent Green right after that, so.
Yeah. He's good. Yes.
Like John Wayne, he also played Genghis Khan.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I can't imagine that. That's just bad, but whatever.
Because... We got to find the tallest white dude we can find to play Genghis Khan. You know, I mean, my God, they talk about, you know, whitewashing characters today in movies, but Hollywood didn't just whitewash characters. They bleached them and then whitewashed them. I mean,
so
Charlton Heston and John Wayne both playing Genghis Khan. Oh, my God. And, okay, I'll say this. And Wayne, they did the makeup was, oh, my God. I'm looking at him, and it hurts my eyes. You know, and Charlton Heston, it wasn't so bad. But, oh, man. Anyway.
The copy you watched on YouTube, was yours, like, fuzzy? Blurry?
Yeah. It was a little bit fuzzy.
Okay.
It probably wasn't a great print that they used, and it's YouTube. I mean, they probably aren't streaming. They stream some stuff in HD, but that probably wasn't.
No,
I might look for
the
DVD. I think it would be neat. It's a beautiful film.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's a good print, really nice print, it would be nice to see that way.
Yeah, I know, like the landscape and stuff. And
right.
Yeah.
Well, it's a beautiful area. Right. I mean, it's just an incredibly spectacularly beautiful place to go.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and my thing is, I felt like the soundtrack was a little bit distorted, you know, because when she was singing, there were times that it was hard for me to tell that it was singing, and that wasn't her voice. That was, you know, just there was a lot going on with the sound, I think.
Yeah.
I also love the subtitles that you shared.
Okay,
I don't know what the hell it was, but it was not English.
Well, here's the thing. So I turned on the automatic subtitle function on YouTube.
Oh, and if you ever,
yeah, and if you ever want to have some fun, do that in a movie that has scenes that are not in English. Because what was happening was, whenever they were speaking Spanish, it was just coming up with gibberish translation because it was trying to translate Spanish, but not into English. It was just trying to find words in English that sounded like the Spanish.
Oh, man.
Oh, and that's why funny. I got poro, 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 among other things. By the way, I'm not sure what poro, poro, poro means in English either. But,
true.
You know, so.
I think it means attack Pearl Harbor or something.
Yeah, that's Tora, 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 Tora. But yeah, you're pretty close, you know. If it was... what if that was the... What if they gave the wrong commands and it was supposed to be Pora, Pora, Pora to not attack Pearl Harbor? Man. And they heard Tora, 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 and they just went straight for it. Oh. Anyway. So Charlton Heston, he was in it. And, yeah.
Yep.
And
his character was a Heston.
He was a big old Heston in this. I mean, and that's, you know, okay. He was a womanizer. He was a thief. He was...
Con man.
A con man. Yeah, he was a bully. Just the list goes on and on and on.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, but by gum, he was... He was the leading man, so he was going to end up with that leading lady no matter what he did. And they were going to have a terrible, abusive relationship.
Yeah, there were no sparks between them.
No, there were sparks, but it was mostly sparks of anger, is all I can see.
Yeah.
I mean, he did nothing nice for her. It's just like, hey, you're going to buy, you need some help, lady? Buy me a beer.
Mm-hmm.
You need some help, lady? Buy me another beer.
Boy, yeah, how much Pisco money you sour.
Got? Yeah. Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. And he kept taking people's unused drinks and pouring them in his glass and drinking them.
Yeah, I know. That was a very casual bit of I don't know. It's just so
perfect for his character, though.
It was perfect for his character, and I like that they thought to have him do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know,
I love that scene at the bar, with Alvy Moore, Hank Kimball from Green Acres.
Oh yeah,
yeah. He was at the bar, and she walked in and asked for what was his name? Harry Steele.
Harry Steele.
Yeah, she walks in asking for Harry Steele.
Yeah, she walks in and asks for Harry Steele, and I went,
of course you would.
Heston.
But that was a good bit.
Yeah, that was cute.
Yeah, but I
just
immediately
like, I'll
saw...
be whatever you need.
Yeah, really. I just kept seeing him as Hank Kimball.
Yeah, and now that you've said who he is, I understand why he looks so familiar to me.
Yeah.
So, there you go.
Yeah, the other one that looked familiar and I couldn't place him was Leon Askin, the guy that played Anton Marshu, a diplomat or a politician?
That's an interesting question because I really never picked up what he was supposed to be other than a wealthy man from behind the Iron Curtain country. Because what was it? It was Romania. Yeah.
Romania, yes. So
he was, and I got the impression that he was kind of a wealthy guy who was also working for the communist state, which kind of is contradictory.
Okay.
But at the same time, that's kind of how it works.
Okay.
You know, he was a powerful, influential man in Romania. And he had to deal with this defector that got away from him.
Okay.
You know. Okay.
Well, I finally looked it up, and he's General Burkhalter from Hogan's Heroes.
Oh, okay.
He was always trying to send Captain Klink to the front or to Siberia.
I'm going to send you to the front, Klink.
Yeah.
What did Colonel Klink? It wasn't Captain Klink.
Colonel Klink. And General Burkhalter. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was great.
Yeah.
He was a great character actor.
Yeah, he was. Mm-hmm. Although, looking back on it, it amazes me that we had a sitcom about life in a German concentration camp.
World camp.
Yeah, it's like, what?
Yeah. Well, we had comedy MASH.
Okay, MASH was not in a Nazi concentration camp, Mary. It was in Korea.
Yeah. Still, it was war.
Well, yeah, it was war, but it wasn't quite as slapstick as Hogan's Heroes.
That's true.
Right?
Yeah. Anyway.
But anyway.
The other one that I recognized was Thomas Mitchell that played Ed Morgan.
Yep.
His Charlton Heston's buddy.
Yeah.
Yeah, the other swindler. Because
he was in a bunch of stuff.
Oh, yeah. He was one of the great American character actors.
Yeah. Yeah. He's in some of the most famous films ever made.
Yep. I remember him as Uncle Billy in A Wonderful Life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think he played Pat Garrett in The Outlaw. What else? Mayor Jonas Henderson in High Noon. Doc Boone in Stagecoach.
He was in Gone with the Wind as well.
Yep. Gerald O'Hara, Gone with the Wind. He was really great.
Oh, come on.
Because people, you see their faces and you recognize them, but you can't place them. It's weird.
Well, you know who my big thing was? I was like, what? He's in this?
What? Who?
It was Robert Young.
I know.
The dad from Father Knows Best. And he looked just like the dad from Father Knows Best. I mean, it was just like... My first thought was, oh, my God, the dad from Father Knows Best is here. Where are the kids? What's going on?
I know.
Are they on vacation? What do you mean he's a doctor of archaeology? What? What do you mean he's a horny doctor of archaeology?
He seems to play that same kind of character.
Yeah, that was pretty funny, though, right. Well, to me.
I remember him as Dr. Marcus Welby.
Yes.
Yeah,
that's true. I guess I grew up seeing Father's Knows Best before I saw Dr. Marcus Welby.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's why I think of him as the dad from Father Knows Best. Plus, he started doing Father Knows Best in 1954, right after, I guess, he finished filming this movie.
Right. Probably.
Yeah, he did it in radio, Father Knows Best in radio, 5 years before it went on to television.
Ah.
So I guess from like 49 to 54, he was doing it on the radio as Jim Anderson. And then it got switched from CBS to NBC because the ratings started to drop, and then it went on for years after that to like 1960. It's amazing.
I have no comment.
Oh. I know.
Killed it. What about who else was in this?
Just that the girl...
Just the girl.
Elena Antonescu.
Ooh, Antonescu, you said it.
I know.
Nicole Maurey, yes.
Yep, Nicole Maurey. And
who was in the Day of the Triffids?
I was just about to say, what other movie was she in that we've done on the podcast? The original Day of the Triffids.
Huh.
Yep.
Okay. Was she blind?
Do what?
Was she blind in Day of the Triffids?
No, I think she was the French girl or whatever, the one that he hooks up with.
Oh, okay.
Wasn't a French girl that he hooked up with, but I don't know.
Well, it makes sense. She's French.
Well, she is French. That's true.
Mm-hmm. But I don't really
know
anything
she's been in. She pulled off the accent really well.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, the Romanian accent. Mm-hmm. So, you know. Because when I was listening, I was like, wow, she's doing a great job with that.
Yeah.
And she was, okay, I will say this. To me, her character was the most fascinating character in the movie.
Yeah.
Because she just had so much going on.
I know.
I mean, no, seriously, because, okay. So, I don't, well, you know what? If we're done talking about the people in it, then I'll just go into the movie and we can talk about why I thought she was fascinating as we roll through it.
Okay. And one last thing I want to say, Robert Young, this is his last film. He never did a film after this. He just went on to television.
Yes. I was about to say, don't say it that way. It sounds like he died right after this.
No, he had to still do Father Knows Best and Marcus Welby.
Yeah. And a bunch of other stuff, too. But But, yeah, that was his last theatrical role.
Yes. Well put.
So there you go.
Yes.
So, okay. So we got this movie, and it starts off with Indiana Jones walking through the jungle with a map. And Wrong movie. Sorry. There are no Hobbitos in this film, and there is no Ark of the Covenant, and there are no Nazis. But what we do have is Harry Steele, dun-dun-dun, played by Charlton Heston. And, okay, I love the way he's described in a lot of the descriptions for the movie, as an American adventurer.
Oh.
Okay, how do you get... Can I be an adventurer? How do you get the title, my job is adventurer? You know, that's something like you would see in like, you know, guys sitting around smoking pipes in the club or something in you know,
the Adventurers
Victorian
Club.
England. And they're sitting around going, yes, I'm an adventurer, you see.
There was a movie
Bombay.
Called that. Wasn't what? There? The Adventurers Club.
Well, maybe. I don't know. Whatever the case, Harry Steele, the most spot-on named dude ever, is an American adventurer who is earning a living as a tour guide in Cusco, Peru. And I think that's funny in the fact that, you know, in one sentence he's described as an American adventurer, and then in the next he's described as making a living as a tour guide. So, how the adventurer has fallen. Anyway, he's making his living doing tours around Cusco, mostly for American tourists who show up. And, you know, he knows he's kind of well connected with the local underworld. And, you know, he's always looking to make his big score. And his idea is that he's going to find the legendary sunburst. And my thought is, he'd been going to... Part of his tour takes him through this museum in Cusco. And the museum had the tiny sunburst on display, which is like a miniature version of this big sunburst, which is like 30 pounds of gold with, you know, I think he describes it as 119 cut diamonds and 200 and some odd other gemstones and 30 pounds of gold, and it's, you know, as big as a platter, and he's just really excited about it. And I think because he was working near that museum, he had just become obsessed with it. And, you know, that's his thing. And he comes into possession of a piece of an ancient carved stone. And this was pretty cool because in the museum, they have this little miniature map. And it's like a layout, supposedly, of this temple where, you know, these Incan rulers are buried. And it's in the lost city of Machu Picchu, and I guess. And this one piece that he's got, when he puts it in the right spot, shows the location of the sunburst.
Ooh.
Yes, ooh. And every, you know, and some people think sunburst is just a legend. He is pretty sure it's real. But, of course, he has a rival. And that rival is Ed Morgan, played by Thomas Mitchell. And Ed Morgan actually hires a dude to shoot at him. And I thought this was the funniest scene because, okay, he hires this guy to shoot at Harry Steele. And the guy misses. He's, I guess, supposed to miss.
Mm-hmm.
Because he was just supposed to scare him. Now, yeah. My thought is, if you're going to hire a dude to shoot at somebody, you better hire him to hit him. Because yeah. You shoot at me and you miss, and you're going to get the kind of reaction that he got, mm-hmm. which is Charlton Heston sees the guy, literally runs across the street up to the guy's room, busts the door in, takes all of his money, smashes his gun, and then the guy's like, but Ed paid me that money, and it's like, yeah, well, it's mine now, isn't it? And he smashes his gun. Who's going to pay for my rifle? And it's such a weird scene mm-hmm. that the guy who was shooting at him, his potential assassin, is griping about his money that Charlton Heston stolen from him.
Mm-hmm.
It's so weird. But anyway, he goes and Harry Steele goes and confronts Ed Morgan. And Morgan's just like, well, you know, you're going to get this treasure and I want it and blah, blah, blah. We should work together, blah, blah, blah. Next time the guy won't miss, blah, 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 whatever. And so you kind of sort of forget about Ed at this point. And I guess that, you know, Harry forgot about Ed too, because as he's on his leading one of his tour groups, a beautiful young lady arrives. Elena Onescu, and he's been told that a woman is going to be arriving who's going to be looking for him for help, and he assumes this is going to be an opportunity for him to make a quick buck, so, you know, he's all for it. Well, he doesn't realize that Elena Onescu is the woman that is, basically, she joins his tour group because she's being chased by the police. And you don't understand why she's being chased by the police until later when she reintroduces herself at the bar. And that's when they have that great scene with the guy that played... Who was he in Green Acres?
Hank Hill.
That's right, he was Hank. So, yeah, and it was Alvin Moore was the guy.
Mr. Steele, Harry Steele.
Well, does the name really matter?
Yes, because my name's Steele. And I'm bigger than you are.
Oh,
So anyway, after Harry Steele meets, you know, Elena Antonescu. Sorry, I'm going to stumble over her name. And she's played by Nicole Maurey. He agrees to sort of help her. Because, first of all, she only has about $50 to her name, but he's making her buy him drinks.
You should have stuck around the museum this afternoon.
I didn't know who you were.
Now you know.
I called Mr. Morgan. He said you would help me.
Mr. Morgan says a lot of things. How'd you know where to find him?
Nina Costa sent me. From the club Granada in La Paz. I worked for her. Dancing.
Club must have changed its policy.
All I do is dance, Mr. Steele.
Call me Harry.
Does he tomar algo, la señorita?
He wants to know if you're drinking.
Oh, thank you. A pisco sour in a tall glass.
Un pisco sour doble.
What's your name?
Elena. Elena Antonescu.
Mr. Morgan said you're from Europe. He didn't say where.
It's not important.
Like that. How'd you get out? Under the fence?
Illegally, yes.
That must have been tough.
They have been trying to get me back ever since.
Six soles.
That'll be six soles. I'm on a budget. Now, what's your problem?
I want to get into the United States.
Why don't you ask me something easy, like a nice murder or a boatload of penicillin?
All I wish from you is to go north. If I can get to Mexico, I will be that much closer to the States.
Then that might take a little time.
You will help me?
Don't rush me. How'd you get across the Bolivian border?
I got across at La Titicaca.
Gave the guards a smile instead of your papers, huh?
I have no papers.
Any particular reason why you left La Paz?
Police. No visible means of support.
They need glasses.
And that's kind of funny, because he's that kind of guy. So he's making her buy him drinks, and then he's like, all right, I'm out of here. And then he sort of, and she starts crying. Yeah. And he's just all like, wow, you did a great job faking those tears. And she immediately stops crying and is just like, oh, whatever, you know.
It worked before.
And, yeah, and then he leaves, and then she breaks down and starts crying again. And my thought is that she maybe really was crying,
mm-hmm.
and he pissed her off so much when he said that, that she was able to stop. But then she started up again because she really was in bad shape. And what's happening is that she was being chased by this dude who, what was his name? Anton Marcoux. Mm-hmm. And Anton Marcoux, played by Leon Askin, he isn't really defined as what he is, as we were saying, but he's kind of an extremely well-connected person from Romania with a lot of money. And he is coming after Elena because she is defected from Romania. And I also get the feeling that she was his girlfriend. And, you know, he was mad that his mistress had taken off and probably used his influence in some way to get out of the country. Because this is 1954 behind the Iron Curtain Romania. You don't just get out of there easily.
Oh,
and,
okay.
You know, so, and her deal is she wants to make her way north to America, but she'll settle for making her way north to Mexico. And so she's like, okay, can you help me? And she describes what's happening to Harry, and Harry's like, okay, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to call this dude and sell you out to him. And then you're going to help me steal the keys to his private plane, which he's got like a little two-seater Cessna. So I'm going to steal his plane, and then we'll get out of here. And she thinks he's going to take her to Mexico. He's like, no, I have the piece to the map, and I know now where the sunburst is buried, so I need to get to Machu Picchu, and the only way to get to Machu Picchu is by airplane. So I'm going to steal this plane, and, you know, we're going to get up there. So anyhow,
but
he lands in a
field. She's going to Mexico.
Yeah, well, she thinks that up until he lands in a field outside of Machu Picchu. And then she's trying real hard with all of her feminine wiles to convince him to go to Machu Picchu. And, you know, I got the feeling that she might have been successful. Or no, wait, I said no. Machu Picchu, yeah. Go to Mexico.
Yeah.
And but turns out, nah, he's just wanting to take her to Machu Picchu. And so when they get there, he's surprised to see that there's like a ton of Peruvians there, and there's a bunch of white dudes there. And the white dudes there are representing a bunch of different museums, and one of them is Dr. Stanley Moorhead, played by Robert Young, you know, our resident Father Knows Best / Marcus Welby dude. And they are on an archaeological expedition because they have just unearthed a new tomb within Machu Picchu. And so because they unearthed this tomb, all these local Peruvians have come up because they're really excited because this means that they may be able to find the sunburst. And what happens, you meet a couple of like a Peruvian priestess, Cora Tika, played by Yama Sumac, I mm-hmm. guess. Okay, yeah. I'm sorry. I'm having a hard time with the YMA name, but Yama Sumac. And then I think it was supposed to be her brother, Pochetku, or Pochetkutik. That's it, Pochetkutik. And Pochetkutik was played by Michael Pate. And they explain that the Incan people will not achieve greatness again until the legendary sunburst is placed back at the
spot that the sunburst goes in, blah, 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 something, something legend, something, something history, something, something curse, blah, blah, blah. You know how it is. I leave all the historical accuracy to Eric.
Yeah.
I'm just a dude talking about a movie. Anyway, so the Incans really want the sunburst. Harry really wants the sunburst because he wants to melt it down and have 30 pounds of gold and a couple of hundred gemstones that he can sell, you know, because it's easily worth $1 million,
mm-hmm.
which $1 million in 1954 would be like $10 million today. So we're talking a decent little bit of change.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, so he and Elena managed to infiltrate this group by saying that their plane ran out of gas, and they asked them if they've got any gasoline to spare, but no, we all hiked up here. And conveniently, Charlton Heston was billeted in the radio tent, so he was able to steal a piece of the radio before they could radio for gas. So he's just ends up sort of stuck with them, and he thinks he's going to be able to get the sunburst, and then he and, Elena can get out of there. Only a monkey wrench is thrown into the works, and that is in the form of Ed Morgan, because his buddy figured that something was up. And so he says, I'm going to follow him to Machu Picchu, come hell or high water, and he ends up there. And more importantly, he steals Harry's revolver. Mm-hmm. Because apparently Harry has the only gun anyone thought to bring into the jungle. Okay, you snort. I'm going to say this. You end up in the wilds of South American jungle, you bring a gun.
Yeah.
You know, just a rifle at least.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't leave home without it. But anyway, so he's kind of at Ed's mercy. And so Ed is like, look, I'll split this with you. Yeah, right. But we got to work together. So they kind of start working together. But what's happening is the whole time that he's doing this, Elena is bugging him that she wants to go to Mexico. But she's also bugging him because she knows what he's doing is wrong. Plus, you know, Stanley Moorhead, our good friend Robert Young, is getting the instant hots for her. And so all of a sudden, she has an opportunity to use her feminine wiles on Stanley Moorhead. And, okay, dude has only known her for like an hour. And he's like, you know, this is kind of awkward. I mean, you being probably 20 years younger than me and me only knowing you for like a half hour. But will you marry me and come to America? And she's like, oh, well, let me think about that. And that's when you know, she's kind of willing to do whatever it takes to get to America.
Mm-hmm.
And that's already been implied, but here we're getting a little bit more serious. And so she's playing all of her cards right now. So she's got Harry Steele on the hook on one hand. She's got Stanley Moorhead on the hook on the other. You know, I wouldn't have been surprised if somebody else hadn't shown up and she'd have been like, hey, big boy.
It's a good thing she was beautiful.
Well, she was beautiful, and that was the thing. Everybody was falling over crazy in love with her right away.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, that's neither here nor there. So, let's see, where were we? Okay, so Ed is trying to steal the sunburst. Charlie, Harry is trying to steal the sunburst. Elena's trying to steal a ride to America. So everybody's got an agenda. Well, what ends up happening is Harry starts noticing just how awful Ed is. And he has this great line at one point when Ed's saying something about, oh, and imagine you get the gold and you've got it and you're rich and blah, blah, blah. And he's like hugging it, fake hugging it and all this. And he stops and looks over at Harry because Harry's looking at him kind of horrified. And he says, what? What is it? He says, I'm looking in a mirror. And I think that was the point when Harry Steele started realizing that maybe I'm an awful person. maybe I'm an awful person.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not going to say that he fully appreciated just how awful he was, but, you know, I think the glimmer of the faintest hint of that idea had crept into his mind. So anyway, one of the things that Harry did was, as he was looking around in the ruins, he found a piece that seemed to fit to something else that was, I guess, somehow referenced in the map that he had with the extra piece. And so he pockets that. Then they break into the last temple, and they don't find anything. The sunburst that they find is just a stone carving on the wall, but it has a strange cutout in the middle of it that looks almost like a mirror. And so Harry Steele is all like, I will sneak in there tonight, and I will use my flashlight and this reflective piece of metal to see what I can find. And sure enough, he shoots his flashlight into the center of the sunburst. A beam of light comes out that hits a spot on the wall which has a dent in it. He takes this metal piece that he stole from another bit of the temple, puts it in there, and that creates a reflection that hits the wall on the other side. He goes over, he starts tearing down the temple walls because hashtag I don't respect a tomb. Sure enough, he finds the sunburst in there. Unfortunately, Ed is smarter than he thought, and Ed gets the drop on him with the only pistol in town. Hello, hashtag bring another gun. So Ed steals the sunburst and takes off. And as he's doing it, he shoots one of the Peruvian guys. And then he ends up shooting a few more of the Peruvians, because at this point there's like 500 Peruvians on top of Machu Picchu, and every one of them is pissed off that, you know, Ed has stolen the sunburst. And of course Stanley and the rest of the party figure that Harry's in on it, including Elena, because she's certain he's in on it too. And there's a big chase, and Ed ends up falling off the mountain, and Harry ends up grabbing the sunburst, and he's got it, and he has to make his decision, and you just don't know what's going to happen. But you kind of do know what's going to happen, because it's a Hollywood movie. Yes, he 50s. Shows up and gives them the sunburst, and, you know, Yama Sumac sings another song, and everybody is super happy because the Incan people can now rise to greatness. And that's why the Incan peoples of Peru are now the third world superpower.
Yeah. It didn't quite
because
work.
They got the sunburst back. And this is what really annoys me. Okay, so Elena is playing both sides of the field with Stanley Moorhead and with Harry Steele. Now, I understand that Stanley Moorhead is kind of a wet rag compared to super adventure man Harry Steele. But you know what? She wants to go to America, and Harry Steele has just given up all the money.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe she ought to be a little bit more eager to hook up with Stanley Moorhead, but that's just me. Besides, you know, if she did hook up with him, then her husband would be the dad from Father Knows Best. I mean, how cool would that be? You think, kids, your dad, Father Knows Best, and then snicker. Yeah, I totally Heston. That's okay.
Yeah.
So, all right. So anyhow, that is most of the secrets of the Incas. Not all of the secret of the Incas, though, because something's got to stay secret, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
So did I enjoy this movie? Yes. Did I think that Charlton Heston's character was a flaming bag of Heston? Yes. I really did. I mean, he was just a big old piece of Heston. That's all there is to it. But it was a fun movie, and it was super interesting to see this. I guess one way I'd seen it described on the internet was he was the proto Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
And I totally see that.
Yeah.
And it also makes me appreciate how less of a flaming bag of Heston Indiana Jones is.
Yeah.
You know, that's all there is to it. Because, you know, Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, not my favorite one. But at the end of that, he has the opportunity to take off with the super valuable artifact. Hashtag spoiler alert for those who haven't seen Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, all three of you. And he gives that back to the village. So it's kind of the same thing that happens here with the Incas.
Yeah.
So anyway, that was a good flick. I enjoyed it. Thank you, Eric. I appreciate that.
You're welcome. Yeah, it's a great film. It's a lot of fun to watch. It's a beautifully shot film. If you've never been to that area, it gives you a real sense of Machu Picchu and the local color of that area of Peru. So it's a neat way to experience that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's got a lot of good stuff going on in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have to wonder, it would seem like to me it would be a hard film to shoot. I would have thought a lot of those actors would have had difficulty with the altitude, etc., being on location like that. I would be interested to know what the shoot was like.
Well, it's interesting because I did a little bit of reading, and one of the things was that they actually, Charlton Heston and the filmmakers, were on site down there in Peru in Cusco and Machu Picchu for about a month.
Wow. That just would be a whole lot easier.
Well, that's what I'm saying, just filming footage.
Yeah.
So before they even started filming, and they only had a 16-person crew, apparently, but they were hanging out in that area for a month filming B-roll.
That makes sense.
And my guess is that was a chance for them to acclimatize also.
Yeah.
You know? Right.
Well, I read that they used like 500 indigenous people. Every one of them
was on the screen.
Those are authentic costumes, and I have pictures when we were there of people in exactly the same costume.
Wow.
Those costumes are such that if you know which is which, they are unique to specific towns or areas. So you can look at the people in their costume and say, okay, that one is from this town or this one is from this town, based on the style of the hat and the colors and style of the clothing and that sort of thing. So, that's all. None of that is costuming. That's all authentic Peruvian clothing.
Cool. It made me want to go to Machu Picchu real bad.
Well, you weren't the only one. Apparently, there was a huge surge in tourism to Peru after the film was released.
I could believe it. Yeah.
Yep. Well, it's a major tourist destination now. There are lots of tour companies that bring people there, although there are some limits on Machu Picchu itself, so only a certain number a day. I will say this, when the pandemic ends, Peru is going to need a serious infusion of tourists because they have been absolutely brutalized by the pandemic. Between the loss of tour income and the fact that the virus has just ravaged Peru, it at one time had the highest death rate in the world.
Wow.
From the disease. They need the income. So if people want to visit, seriously consider doing it. It's a great trip. And it will be of great benefit to a country that needs the resources.
Yeah. Well, I've been wanting to go. I have a girlfriend who, I think she was born there. If she wasn't born there, she was born here in the U.S. and then went over there and spent her, like, till her teens in Peru. And her brother's still there. And he flies a plane. So I think that would just be, like, the greatest trip to go there and take a small plane out. And I love that scene where they were just landing that plane in that grove
in the field.
Yeah. Because there's a place down here in Colombia that has a small airfield here, and Vince and I used to be in this club of experimental aircraft, and you could go down there, and people needed to get their flight hours in, you know, to keep their pilot's licenses, but it's expensive. So they would take you up in their small, you know, 2- and 4-seater planes as long as you would pay for the gas. And that way they would, you know, get their hours in. And we went down one time and got in one of the small planes. It was like a four-seater. I don't remember what it was. But we flew out all over Colombia, and we were landing in little fields like that. And it was like the neatest experience to, you know, you're so used to being in a giant plane with an asphalt runway, but you get in a little tiny plane like that and you're flying around and you see a clearing and suddenly you land in it. And it's just, it's a really neat experience. So that would be neat to do that in Peru.
Okay, I'm going to say, Mary, that what you just described also sounds like a really terrifying experience when the plane is going down and you're like, there's a clearing.
Yeah.
Try and make it.
It is. Yeah. Ah. Yeah. One of the times that we landed, it was for him to get gas, and it was just a small farmer's field, and the guy had an airplane fuel tank there. And he,
well, that's awfully convenient.
Yeah. Well, that's, you know, it's a gas station. They all knew where it was. It's out in the middle of nowhere. It's just a farmer's field.
Fair.
Yeah. Cool. But anyway, I want to go. I can't
wait. Well, maybe we'll all go to Peru together.
That would be wonderful.
There you go.
I would love that. I need to go with somebody who speaks Spanish because I don't.
Like I said, maybe we won't go to Peru together.
I speak Spanish. I'll go and be your interpreter.
Yeah, I need that. Cool.
Oh, mucho gusto, Eric.
Yeah, muy bueno. Sí, señor.
Yo quiero cerveza.
Ugh. Heston.
Heston, indeed. And on that note, Mary, do we have any feedback for this
week? Yes, we do. We have a little tiny bit of feedback, so
I will start. A tiny bit of feedback.
A tiny bit of feedback.
Is it from a tiny person?
No.
Do you know that for sure?
No, actually, because I've never met any of these people.
Well, see, there you've met a ton of the people that are listeners.
Not the ones that... Well... No.
Okay, just you're about to insult some people, Mary, so we're just going to drop.
No. I mean, I think out of all the people that wrote in this time, I've only met Nick Havert.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, anyway.
Anyway, this first one is from Paul White, and he says, "Hi, Mary, I heard the latest episode where you were asking for whoever is maintaining the letterbox list of movie titles to write in and let you know." He says, "That's me."
Yay!
It's Paul White in Canada is the one that's been taking care of our letterbox problem all these years.
You should send him a koozie.
Or a car, right?
What is the letterbox problem?
Well, I was going to say, 19 more koozies to get a car. Remember, kids, you don't just get a car. It's 20 koozies for a car. But fine, whatever, Mary.
Okay. The letterbox problem was that I noticed somebody was keeping up the letterbox thing that's linked to our account. And keeping up with all the shows we were doing and putting it on Letterboxd, and I didn't know who was doing it. That was really nice. So, thank you. Thank you, Paul White in Canada.
Yes, for real. Thank you, Paul.
Yes. This next one is from Nick Havert, the comic book guy, and he's also... what is that? Who's the character he does with the skeleton face?
I'm not saying.
Okay, thank you. I'll remember right before I climb into bed tonight, probably. Anyway, Nick says, "Hello, gang. I hope you're all doing well and staying healthy. I'm still catching up on old episodes and wanted to chime in with a few comments. Regarding Tremors, I love that film and was stunned to see how many sequels there have been since the second one. I, for one, love the alternate swear words they used, like mother humpers, and chuckle every time I hear it. Deadly Game, Dial Code Santa, Home Alone in France is a wild, weird movie that I first saw on Shudder when Joe Bob Briggs and Diana Darcy Prince hosted it last Christmas. My theory is that most of the film is a dream that the kid has after he falls asleep waiting up for Pierre Noel. It explains the weird cartoonish look and layout of the house and the kid's fear of his mom's new boyfriend becoming closer to her and possibly moving into the fairy tale kingdom his family has there." That, I never thought about it like that. I was taking it as actual fact. But that's a nicer way to see the movie.
It is a nicer way to see it. I think from talking with the writer-director, that's not what happened, but...
But the dog wouldn't die in his version.
That is a cool way to see it.
But the doggy doesn't die in his version.
Well, yeah, but remember the guy said the dog had to die because you had to take the movie from the positive thing that it was into the terrifying situation that it becomes.
Yeah.
And that's how you kind of know that everything's gone Heston.
I shouldn't have told you about his name.
No, you shouldn't have, because that's my thing.
I know.
It's a big old pile of Heston.
Mm-hmm. And you can insult people all over the place, and they wouldn't have any idea you were insulting them.
I think they'd pick it up pretty quick, especially if they're a listener to the B-Movie Cat.
True. Okay, he goes on to say, thanks for the episode on The Phantom of the Convent, and I'll be sure to track that down. I'm delighted to see you're covering Black Sunday. Mario Bava plus Barbara Steele equals a gothic masterpiece. And it was. And that was a great podcast.
Yeah.
And I still can't get over the fact that we had Martine Beswick on. Whew. Okay, he goes on to say, I'm in the middle of writing multiple comic book projects that cover everything from murder mystery to a Western. I'm also working on two more books about films. The first is a book about car chase movies. Okay.
Cool.
What is that car chase that's in San Francisco?
You're talking about Bullet.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. I'll give you.
First is a book about car chase movies and films with great car chases in them. The other is about FilmMac Studios, FilmMack, who created a lot of drive-in and movie theater footage. Okay, and yes, I'm still hosting Weirdorama. That's what I was thinking about. And recently posted episode 108, which has the supernatural romantic comedy I Married a Witch.
Oh.
I've never seen that one. Sounds good. Take care of yourself. I hope to see you all at a convention soon, maybe in the fall.
So, yay.
Nick Havert, comic book guy. Anyway, he is so busy. He just reading what he's doing makes me tired. He has so many projects going on.
Fair.
Yes. Okay, this last one is from Don Falcos.
Anyway, he's writing to tell you what color car he wants.
He says, that makes six. That's how many koozies he has so far.
Oh, Lord, he's way off, Mary. Says, dude's got at least 14 more koozies to win.
He says, let me see. If I'm remembering correctly, it's 10 for a t-shirt and 15 for a new car. Is that right?
20 for a car, dude. Don't push it.
And he says his latest koozie number 6 has arrived, and he's added to his Emir collection display.
That's awesome.
Yeah. That's it. That's the feedback.
Well, that's lots of feedback. But you know what? What it lacks in quantity, it makes up for in quality.
It's true.
There you go.
It's true.
Yep. And I want to take a minute to thank Eric for coming on the show and
definitely
dropping some archaeological bombs on us, man. Yes, thank you.
That was lots of fun. You all said last time, you all talked about doing the Evil Dead films or Dead Alive. And if you all want to do any of those, I would love to do any of those, because those are all great films.
Okay. For some reason, I thought we did those, but Nick says we haven't.
Well, why don't you look at the website and see if you find them, Mary?
Because it takes forever to go through there.
So you want me to do it?
Wait, I have a printout of them.
We have not done The Evil Dead.
Who directs in The Evil
Dead? Sam Raimi.
That's how we got his start.
Why am I thinking he has something to do with the Spanish movies?
You're thinking of The Blind Dead.
That's
this conversation last time.
Blind Dead, Evil Dead, Living Dead, they're all dead.
They're all dead. They're just all messed up.
It sucks to not have
they're
a memory.
All messed up. Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So,
Twyla will sort them out, so that's okay.
Sounds good. Because I've seen bits and pieces of that, but I don't think I've ever sat down and watched the whole movie.
What, the Evil Dead?
Yeah.
Okay, do you know which one you've seen bits and pieces of?
Probably the first one. Because that would be the one that they would show the most on television.
Maybe, but I don't know. The first one's probably considered the most controversial.
Oh, okay.
Oh, right. Mary perked right up. Oh, controversial, you say. Raw.
It's my kind of movie.
Raw. Yes, it is the tree rapiest of all of the movies.
Yes.
Tree.
Among other things.
Okay.
So.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I think that is the movie I saw. I do remember a tree.
Oh, Mary can't forget a good tree rape scene.
I think that. I remember a tree. I don't know.
Are you sure you aren't thinking of, like, one of the Lord of the Rings movies with the Ents?
Mm-mm.
And it's just a big tree walking around talking real slow?
Wait, Lord of the Rings is one with that little weird Gandalf guy or something.
What?
Right?
Okay, no, Mary.
The little guy that slobbers all over the ring. That little creature.
If by slobbers all over the ring, you mean bites Frodo's finger off.
Yeah, but when he has it, he just sits there and fondles it and slobbers all over it. It's creepy. What was that character? What was his name?
Gollum,
yeah.
Oh, good Lord. See, sorry, I was too busy shaking my head to answer.
I think I've only watched the first one of those.
Oh, well, you've only got... Okay, with the extended versions for all three of the first movies, you're probably looking at 10 hours of viewing.
Wow.
Yep.
And then you add in The Hobbit, which, right, by the way, I have not even seen the third movie of.
See, I've never read the book, so I don't know the story, and the movies were really confusing for me.
Okay, Mary, I will recommend that you read The Hobbit.
Yeah, I know.
The Hobbit is an excellent book.
I know.
As for the Lord of the Rings trilogy, is a long read.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to say watch the movies and enjoy that.
Okay.
Because you'll get all the pleasure of the Lord of the Rings with half the calories.
Okay. That's what I need right now. Half the calories.
Yep.
I hate this pandemic.
Wow, somehow we brought dieting into this. You're welcome.
Yeah. Anyway, right. Thank you for coming on the show, Eric. And
yeah, always a pleasure. Always glad to do it.
Yeah.
Always look forward
to it. Thanks, Eric.
Twyla says hi. She's sitting next to me reading and petting the cat.
Hi, Twyla. I like your Shih Tzus.
Yes. They're probably sitting outside the gate of our bedroom. We have a baby gate to keep the Shih Tzus and the cat apart. And they're probably sitting outside of it looking at the cat, thinking, that's not right. Mommy and Daddy are supposed to be out here with us. But
they don't get
that's
along.
Okay. We're out there with them most of the time. So
the puppies don't get along with the kitty?
Well, I think in time they don't interact that much, honestly, but it's just an easier thing to give the cat a place where she can go, they can't.
Yeah.
Otherwise they might get a little obsessed with her and that would not be good. So it's just easier that way. Someday, who knows, maybe we'll be able to take the gate down, but so far we've just left it.
Okay.
The cat goes wherever she wants. But it gives her a way to get away from the dogs so that they aren't going to harass her.
Yeah. That's a good idea. How long have you had the cat?
What are we, 5 years, I think?
Oh, okay.
Like that.
Yeah, my cat doesn't get along with anything. Cat or dog or squirrel.
Now, that we definitely couldn't have because the cat and the dogs would rip the squirrel apart. They chase squirrels. They're big into hunting squirrels in the backyard.
Kitty.
St. Mary's going to invite you over now.
Yeah, really. Bring the dogs.
You got squirrels. Our dogs would come. They love them.
Kitty chases them. She just never catches them.
Yeah, she doesn't want to catch them.
She doesn't. She stalks them and then jumps towards them. And then right before she's ready to jump on them, she stops. It's like she tries.
Do you know how much work it is to deal with a dead animal? Kitty knows better than that.
No, she's brought some in for me. Little moles and lizards. She likes lizards.
Poor lizards.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, let's get off the dead animals. Yes. And... All right. Thanks again, Eric.
Yes. Thank you.
It was a fun show. Anytime.
Sounds good. I think we better wrap this up. I'm getting real tired.
Well, let's call it an evening. Okay. Thanks a lot.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Inti's daughter sang this song when she and the virgins of the temple were claimed by the sun.
Good job?
No, just for now. It wasn't the right time for us to meet. But there'll be other nights, other stars for us to watch. They'll be back.
The ghosts are moving tonight, restless, hungry.
All right, fellas, here's your story. Greetings, my friend. We are all interested in the future, for that is where you and I are going to spend the rest of our lives. And we cannot keep this a secret any longer.
Wait, Captain. I have found evidence of intelligent beings on this planet.
Look to the skies. It's the B-Movie Cookbook. Menus inspired by 15 of your favorite B-movies from the 1950s. With teenage werewolves, blobs, and enough cheese for everyone.
When we return to our planet, the High Court may well sentence you to torture.
But until then, we've got Ed Wood and Vincent Price.
There'll be food and drink and ghosts, and perhaps even a few murders. You're all invited.
So impress your friends with dinner and a movie with the B-Movie Cookbook. We've got you covered. Get your copy today at bmoviecookbook.com. That's bmoviecookbook.com.
Let me see that book. I am interested to see what sways your mind so heavily.
Sure thing. Just visit bmoviecookbook.com.
Anybody around here want some coffee?
Transmission.
guys always win, even in the 80s.